Psalms chapter 32, we will read one verse from this chapter, then you will be seated and we will read some more. I hope that you have your Bibles with you. Amen. Psalms 32 and verse number 7, the Bible says that thou art my hiding place. Oh, I'm thankful for that. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble, and thou shalt compass me about or surround me with songs of deliverance. Selah. Are you thankful that the Lord can be your hiding place? The Bible says you can run therein and are safe. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run therein. He hides us. He surrounds us. He compasses us about with songs of deliverance. There's victory in hiding in the Lord. There's joy in hiding in the Lord. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Tracking back on this chapter to verse number 1, the Bible says, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. Verse number 3 transitions, he says, when I kept silent, when I didn't do this getting forgiveness, and when I did not have the Lord help me, my bones waxed old through my roarings all the day long. From day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. Selah. Verse 5, he transitions, he says, I acknowledged my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Selah. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. Verse number 6 says, for this shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee in a time when thou mayest be found. When thou mayest be found. It's reminiscent to a message about a month ago, a little more than a month ago, when God gives up. But he says, I pray unto thee when you can still be found. Surely in the floods of great waters thou shalt not come nigh unto me. Verse number 7, our text for this morning, thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt, when I run to you, when I admit, when I confess, when I put myself in you, you preserve me, you keep me, you protect me from trouble, and thou shalt surround me or compass me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. This is a result of being hid in him. I will guide thee with mine eye. I want you to pay close attention to that verse. He's saying, this person that hides themselves in the Lord is instructed and taught in the way that he should go, and the guiding of that instruction is done with the eye. How many parents remember when you just had to look? Or maybe you remember being looked at. Right? And that would, well, it was years ago, admittedly. That would do something, wouldn't it? There was such a submission and such a connection that just a look could be the guiding point. I had to have more parts of the body engaged than just the eye. One of the things I remember as a small child in church was the snap. My mother, who is not here, please pray for my parents. They took a flight this morning at 6:15 to preach a conference this week, and they'll be back next week. So pray for them. Anywhere you go that leaves at 6:15, you need prayer. So anyway, but my mom had this snap. It was actually sharper than that. I can't do it. But I don't care where she was, and I don't care where I was. This ear was tuned to the tone of that snap. And man, I would be like, how many remember those? So he says here in verse number 8 that I'll guide you with my eye. This is the result of the kind of relationship that is being exposed here, that just the eye could guide you. He says in verse number 9, he says, be ye not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, lest they, the bit and bridle, come near unto thee. I just want to preach about verse 7. But I want you to hear verse 9 and 10. Or verse 8 and 9. Because the Lord wants his children to have such a connection with him and be such as submitted to him that he does not have to use the bit and bridle in order to lead and to guide his people. Verse number 10 says, many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he that trusteth in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. Be glad in the Lord. Find fulfillment in him. Find your joy in the Lord. Find your happiness in the Lord. And rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart. All ye that are upright in heart. That 11 verses of this chapter of Psalms 32 gives us a great indicator of the transition from one who is outside of the Lord and one that transitions to being hid in Christ. The challenge of being led and guided by the Spirit of the Lord to the challenge of having to have the bit and the bridle in order to manage the direction in which you're going. But he's our hiding place. It's an invitation, this passage of Scripture. It's an invitation to run to him. It's an invitation to place ourselves in his arms. It's an invitation of promise that says, regardless of where you are, there's a place that you can get to that is not where you are. It's a transition piece. It's in 11 verses we see salvation actually laid out here. That when I confess, then I'm able to place myself in the salvific process to be hid, led, and guided as the Lord would guide me. And as a result, I can rejoice, shout, be fulfilled, and find happiness. Come on, somebody, we got to recognize that we live in a time period that life is susceptible to the temptations, the difficulties, the stumbling blocks, the pits of sin in this world, and we've got to be hid from all that stuff. We got to find a place that we can be compassed about, surrounded with. We've got to recognize that there are many, many obstacles that would hinder us from rejoicing, for shouting with joy, from having an upright heart, being compassed about with one that we can trust in and one that trusteth us. We have the hurricanes of life that are within that cause confusion in our mind of the ripping one way and another way of confusing thoughts and determination of outside sources that would cause what we would say a hurricane on the inside of our mind. But God wants to know that you to know that no matter how strong the storm is, he has the ability to either calm you or calm the storm regardless of the hurricane. We are susceptible to overwhelming tempests of spiritual distress that can be caused by choices, decisions that take us in the wrong direction and take us in the wrong direction at a rapid pace. It's almost as if one would be on a train traveling at a high rate of speed where the tracks run out. That's what sin is like. That's what the hurricanes of life are like. It's hard to get off a moving train. It's hard to get that train stopped all by yourself. But there is a place that you can run to. There's a place in which you can hide. There's a place that we can be hid from the wild attacks of humankind and our enemies and those who taunt and those who slander and those who threaten and sin. That sin, as Paul describes it, that so easily besets us, and that stumbling block that always shows up in the middle of our path. Can somebody acknowledge, yeah, I got it licked this time. But it seems like next month comes around and there I am all over again, stumbling and falling. There's a place that you can run. I want you to understand that. There's a place that you can hide. I want you to recognize that. There's a wall that God can build around you of songs of deliverance that would cause you to shout with joy and cause you to rejoice all day long. But you got to stay in the hiding place. You can't sneak out. You can't wander out.
You can't walk out or else you're going to be exposed. But if you can stay in the hiding place, if you can manage to be in the tower, if you can get within the songs of deliverance, there's safety in the hiding place. I said there's safety in the hiding place. We all have hiding places of different kinds. Mostly children have hiding places that are visible. Adults have hiding places that are not easily seen. As kids, we used to have our hiding places. Sometimes we call them forts. Clubs, no girls allowed. Then it transitioned to only girls allowed. You know those hiding places that you would run to when your parents make you mad, when school's too hard, when a street bully picks on you. I used to have a hiding place. I remember one specifically. Matter of fact, Brother Smith, it was in the house that we lived on First Street in Rockville. Sister Basham's not here, is she? Elder Sister Basham. Your sister Donnell. It was over kind of near where they lived. Matter of fact, that was the house that you and my dad would ride your motorcycles up and down the hill a couple years ago. There's a little place, a little thicket that you had to be small to get into. Once you got in there was a lot of space. Remember those hiding places? Nobody could find you. As adults, we have our hiding places too. We retreat into our minds. We stay at work a little bit longer. We stay out a little bit later. Maybe we pull the shades and pull the covers over our head and we sleep the day away. The hiding places of the internet, technology, gaming stations. Finding a place where we don't have to deal with the reality of the storm that is going on in our life. Can somebody say amen? Amen. These hiding places as children and as adults, we never really get out of finding them. They just change names. The problem is that our hiding places as the transition from childhood to adulthood become more damaging to us. All of it to get out of the pressure, to get away from the wind, to get out of the emotional rain that is pelting us, that life is throwing at us. Only to realize that our hiding place is really not hiding us at all. We're still lonely at the end of the day. We're still tired of it all at the end of the day. We're still dealing with the temptation and the struggle at the end of the day. We're still confused that we don't know up from down and left from right and who to trust and who we can embrace and who we keep at arm's length. And we are running from hiding place to hiding place, trying to find some kind of hope, trying to realize some kind of relief, trying to find a place that we can just catch our breath from running from one to another, to another. And we yell out, is there anybody that can help me? Is there anything that I can be a part of to give me any peace? Is there any institution that can put any kind of sense to this confusion that I'm involved in? Is there anybody that can help me? And the simplicity of my message this morning is that God is the only entity that can help a person when they are in the middle of life's raging storm. God is the only one. He's the only one that can hide us from the storms of life. He's the only one that can take us out of the temptation of sin when we call upon His name. He's the only one that can help us resist the devil and watch the devil flee from us. He's the only one that can compass us about with songs of deliverance. That in the middle of the most difficult time of my life and your life, we can lift our hands and rejoice and say, thanks be unto God that giveth me the victory. I am a conqueror because I have found Him and I'm hiding in Him. Come on, somebody. You got to understand that God is the only hiding place that can truly hide you from whatever is ailing your system, whatever is messing up your mind, whatever is pulling you and stretching you and causing you to be miserable. God is the only hiding place. Drugs are not a hiding place. Alcohol is not a hiding place. Sexual encounters are not hiding places. Multiple relationships are not hiding places. A raise on your job is not a hiding place. A new house or a new car is not a hiding place. Those are temporary relief systems that only bring you up and drop you right back down. But when you place yourself in the hands of the Creator, when you place your life in Him, truly, truly when He lifts you up, truly when He lifts you up, there ain't no coming down when God lifts you up. I wish somebody would get a hold of what I'm saying this morning. I wish there'd be a testimony this morning that would say, when I was down, God lifted me up, and I've never had to experience that down again. No, I've had problems, I have challenges, I've had difficulties, but I'm hid in the middle of the challenge. I'm hid in the middle of the difficulty. I'm hiding in Him. I'm hiding in Him. I said, I'm hiding in Him. When the alcohol wears off, I'm exposed again. I'm exposed again. But when I walk out of this church, I'm taking the hiding place with me. It doesn't dissipate. It doesn't evaporate. It doesn't leave me. As long as I stay in Him, I'm compassed about with songs of deliverance. That's why I can walk into work tomorrow and I can say, yeah, I'm still going through a challenge, but hallelujah, I'm rejoicing because this is the day the Lord hath made. Greater is He that's in me than he that is in the world. I've got joy, unspeakable joy. I've got full of glory. Hallelujah. God's on my side, I'm on His side. And together we're a winning team. But when the drugs wear off, and when the sex wears off, and when all the fun wears off, and you can't sleep at night, and your money's all gone, and your friends have left you, and you got nowhere to be, and you're trying to figure out the next step in life, you are exposed. That's why this whole chapter is about confessing, correcting, and inhabiting. Turn to your neighbor and say, God. Come on, turn to your neighbor and say, God can be your hiding place. Temptation as you walk out of this building, temptation will say, what about me? Can God hide you from me? I say to you, as truly man, sympathizing with us, the Bible says that he was tempted in all points, yet he sinned not. I say to temptation, God can hide me from temptation and deliver me. Come on, somebody, you got to understand. When sin rears its ugly head up to you and said, participate, you need to say, God can hide me from this in Jesus' name. Tuesday or Wednesday, confusion of life will rear its ugly face right up nose to nose with you and say, where's your God now? I say to you, as more than man, Jesus stepped to the bow of the boat and spoke to confusion and said, peace, be still. And so I say, God can hide you in the middle of confusion. As Satan would throw his fiery darts at you from his hiding place. Come on, you ever been walking down the street like, oh, where'd that come from? Oh. Say, can God protect you from these missiles? I say that the scripture says that he is our shield and our buckler, that he can cover us from whatever blast Satan sends our way, that God can. Somebody shout out, God can. Come on, somebody shout out, God can. In confusion, God can. In temptation, God can. The fiery darts, God can. Whatever you're facing, God can. In your family, God can. On your job, God can. In your home, God can. In your finances, God can. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. There's nothing too hard for him. I said there's nothing too hard for him. There's nothing too complicated for him. You may be laying at bed at night, staring up at the ceiling, contemplating about how complicated the web of life and sin and decisions have covered you, and it seems as if you cannot get out from underneath of the complicated situation that you are in. Can somebody testify that, yes, I understand what you're saying? Come on, have you ever tried to unwind something maybe of your own doing or of some other doing in your life? And it's like, I'll never unwind this. It's too complicated. There's too many personalities. There's too many people. There's too many parts to this. I'm going to suffocate because it's too complicated for me to get out of. Is that just me or is that anybody? Come on, am I the only one that stares at the ceiling in the middle of the night and say, how in the world, God, can even you figure this out? Come on, anybody else been up at 3 o'clock in the morning with me and say, God, are you able? Are even you? Even you, God, are you able to do this? Well, God specializes in the complicated. Look at your neighbor. There it is. He specializes in the complicated. They're here. He specializes in the complicated. Don't let the devil tell you your situation is too complicated for God to walk you through it and hide you in the middle of it. He specializes in the complicated. Do you know that you have somewhere around 200 bones in your body, 600 muscles that are operating even right now, thousands of miles of blood vessels, 400 cups on your tongue to taste food, 20,000 hairs in your ear to pick up sound. You have 40 pounds of jaw pressure to eat by, 10 million nerve endings and branches, 3,500 sweat tubes every inch of your skin, which extend up to 40 miles if put end to end, 20 million little mouths in your intestines to process the food that we eat, 600 million air cells in your lungs to inhale the air that we breathe, 2,400 gallons of air pumped daily through your lungs, 12 tons of blood being pumped throughout our heart, which beats 4,200 times every hour. God knew us from the very foundations of the world. He knows the very number of hair on your head. He named you from the beginning. He specializes in the complicated. If he can make this system with all of those components work in order for us to be processed through life, then my little situation, my little challenge, my little difficulty, if God's able to take all of my bones and muscles and blood vessels, all of the nerve endings and sweat tubes and the intestines and the air and the blood, if he's able to make that into a human being of productivity, then God is able to walk into my situation, cover me up, hide me in the middle of it, and walk me right on out of it while I'm being hid in him. Don't let the devil tell you God's too small or God doesn't care about you at all. He cares about you. He knows who you are, where you are, what you're going through. What he needs is for somebody to acknowledge him and say, I'm running to you, Lord Jesus. I need to be hid in you. I need to be hid in you. Come on, he's the way maker. He's the mediator. He's the high priest. He's the prophet. He's the deliverer. He's the resurrection. He's my burden bearer. He's not too small. He's not too big. He's the right size for me and for you. He's the lily of the valley. He's the fairest of 10,000. He's the everlasting hope in my life. He's the coming king. He's everything that I need when I need him, just exactly how I need him. He's exactly right on time when I need him. He has the right amount of what I need when I need it. He's everything, every minute of every day, of every week, of every month, of every year, and I can't leave him. I can't can't get away from him. I've got to be hid in him or I'm going to fall apart. I need to be compassed about with songs of deliverance. What do you need in your life? When Abraham needed him on Mount Moriah, he became the sacrifice. When Moses needed him, he became the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire. When Aaron needed him, he became the rod that budded. When Gideon knew him, he knew him as the angel of the Lord. Ruth knew him as the kinsman redeemer. Samuel knew him as the Ark of the Covenant. Elijah knew him as the still small voice. Solomon knew him as the wisdom of Israel. Isaiah knew him as the one high and lifted up. Ezekiel knew him as the wheel in the middle of the wheel. Daniel knew him as the handwriter on the wall. Joel knew him as the Holy Ghost baptizer. Haggai knew him as the desire of all nations. Micah knew him as the son of righteousness. To the architect, he's the chief cornerstone. To the builder, he's the sure foundation. To the farmer, he's the Lord of hosts. To the editor, he's good tidings of great joy. To the sculptor, he's the living stone. To the theologian, he's the author and finisher of our faith. To the preacher, he's the word of God. Others have known him as the gift of gifts. The wonder of wonders, the Lord of lords, the King of kings, the Master of masters, the friend of friends, the hope of hopes, the Ancient of Days, the arm of the Lord, the branch of righteousness, the balm of Gilead, the creator of all things, the day spring from on high, the express image of the Father. He's the Lamb of God. He's the Alpha. He's the Omega. He's the beginning and he is the ending. He's the tabernacle in the wilderness. He's the transfigured sun. He's the brightness of God's glory. And ladies and gentlemen, he's the same yesterday. He's the same today. And he's going to be the same forevermore. He can be the fountain of our joy. He can be the bread on our table. He can be the song in the middle of our night. He can be the foundation of your structure, the source of your comfort, the rock of your shelter, the captain of your warfare, the shepherd of your pasture, the strength of your days, the pilot of your ship, the means of your assurance, the solution to your problem, the delight of your soul, the object of your worship, the giver of our blessings, the lawyer in our case, the oasis in our desert, the author of our salvation, the door of our prison, the way in our wilderness, the wisdom of our decision, the builder of our faith, the healer of our body, the backbone of our boldness, the energy of our strength, the sacrifice of our altar, the composition of our creed, the cause of our hope, the head of our church, and the God of my life. He is my hiding place. I said, he is my hiding place. Whatever I need in the morning, he's everything to me. What I need in the afternoon, he's everything to me. When I wake up in the morning, I need to wake up with a hallelujah on my lips. When I go to bed at night, I wake up, I go to bed with hallelujah on my lips. I'm hid in him from the beginning of the day all the way to the end of the day, because I can't handle it in the world. I can't handle sin. I can't handle temptation. I need to be hid in him. I said, I need it. I have to have it. I can't live without him. I cannot live without him. God, let's stand. God asked the question to Israel at a time where they were doubting him, questioning him. How many could be sincere this morning and say, there's been some situations where I've doubted God? Been times where, man, it's gone too far. It's too much time has passed. I don't think there's hope. How many's been there before? I've been a part of too much. My life has been wrecked. The road doesn't lead back. That's what we think. And really, when it boils down to it, what separates us from where we are and where God is one word called pride. It's pride that keeps a person gripping the edge of the pew and not move. It's pride that doesn't allow for the verse 5 of Psalms 32. It's pride that doesn't allow verse 5 when he says, I acknowledge my sin unto thee. And my iniquity have I not hid. I will confess my transgressions. This last part can only be said when the first part is done. Thou forgavest the iniquity. It is our humanity that does not allow for us to cross the road to the place where God can embrace us, hide us. He's everything and can be anything for everybody at the exact same moment. If there's somebody needs encouragement, somebody needs uplifting, somebody needs forgiveness, somebody needs an answer, somebody needs a door open, somebody needs a way, somebody needs the repair of the breach, in an instant, God can be every one of those at the same time. But he will not force himself to manifest to your need unless invited. And pride keeps us from inviting him. Jeremiah writes the Lord's words in Jeremiah 32 and 27. He says, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Is there anything too hard for me? That relationship that you know you need to get out of, but you can't imagine how to fill that void when it's gone. God says, that's not too hard for me. That's not too hard for me. That addiction that has got you so entangled and wrapped up and entrapped. Currently, your brain cannot compute how you would live without it. God says, that's not too hard for me. That's not too hard for me. The financial trouble that you're in, and you're investing every single waking moment in trying to handle it yourself, when you should be investing in your spouse and your kids and your godliness in your home. You can't imagine how we pay the bills if I turn my attention to you and not to this problem. God says, hey, I'm the God of all flesh. It's not too hard for me. That's not too hard for me. What God was telling Israel that day, what God is telling you and me today, is put me to the test and see if it's too hard for me to handle. Because if it's too hard for me to handle, then you can go back to what you were involved in. You wouldn't have lost the thing. But if I can handle it, you will have gained everything. When we leave here today, in the next few minutes, we have to make sure that we have taken shelter in Jesus Christ. We have to come to Him. That's what a hiding place is. A hiding place is a location. A hiding place is a place in which you must travel to, whether it be in the back of your closet, whether it be on your computer and websites, whether it be the phone call that you periodically return, the text message that you every now and again send. It's a place that you have to go to. And God is also a place that you have to go to. Foolish people hear about the hiding place, but they never get to it. How great is their folly? It makes Jesus and the work that He did on the cross of no value, no effect in their life. It's available, but they never access it. It's like a roof. What good is a roof to someone who lies out in the open? What good is it if you're unwilling to put yourself under it? Or what good is a life preserver floating next to someone who's drowning in the ocean if they don't reach out and grab it? Jesus this morning is making Himself available to all of humanity under the sound of my voice. In Colossians, as we close, in Colossians chapter 3, verse number 1, the Bible says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Here it is. Are you ready? Verse 2. Set your affection on things above,
not on things on the earth. Verse 3, for ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. God wants to become your hiding place. Every hand lifted in the building, we love you, Lord Jesus. Prayer partners, if you'll come. We love you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, for your mercy and your grace in our life, Jesus. We recognize, Lord God, that our need is not of external, temporal things, but our need, Lord, is for higher, eternal things. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for making yourself available to each and every one of us, God. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for opening your arms and allowing us the opportunity to run to you. Allowing us the opportunity, Lord Jesus, to be hid in you. I pray right now, God, that we can get past our humanity right now. Get past our pride. Get past our sinful ways. Get past our flesh. Get past, Lord, embarrassment. Get past those things that are doing nothing for us, Lord, but hindering us from getting to you. And Lord, that we would have what it takes to run to you, to the hiding place. It's a location, God, and we must place ourselves there. We must place ourselves there in Jesus' name. Now grab the hand of the person next to you, and I want you to pray for that person next to you, that God would begin to help them, touch them, work on them, that God would soften their heart to make a decision to come to the hiding place in Him, that God would speak to their life right now, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Lord, I pray for the person on either side of us, Lord God. I pray, Lord Jesus, that whatever challenge they may be going through, God, that they find that hiding place in you, Jesus. I pray, Lord God, that whatever turmoil, whatever circumstance, God, whatever challenge, Lord, they may be faced with, whether it be on the job, whether it be in their home, whether it be in their relationships, God, whatever it may be, God, that you would hide them in the middle of that, Lord Jesus. That God, I know we can't get out of trouble, but Lord, we can hold your hand as you take us through trouble, Jesus. I thank you for the hiding place that's available, Lord God. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Down in the front are prayer partners that want to pray with you this morning. If you want to walk your way out of your storm and walk your way into the hiding place, I encourage you right now to get out of your pew, and I encourage you, there should be somebody running to this altar right now and saying, God, I can't handle the storm anymore. I can't handle the wind anymore. I can't handle the rain anymore. I've got to have you hide me. I want to be hid in Christ. Come on, is there anybody here this morning? Don't leave here today without being hid in Christ. Don't leave here today. Come on, with the hand of the person that you're holding, turn to them and say, do you want to go to the altar this morning? Do you want to go and be hid in Christ this morning? Come on, ask them, ask them, ask them. Ask the person next to you, do you want to go be hid in Christ this morning? I'll go with you and we can be hid in Christ this morning. I don't want to leave here without the covering of God in my life. I don't want to leave here without being passed about with songs of deliverance in my life. I don't want to leave here without victory and joy and peace in my life. Come on, somebody. Come on, make a move this morning. That's right. That's right. That's right. Come on, make a move this morning. You got to go to the location.
You got to go to the location. The hiding place is a location, and you got to find it. You got to find it in Him. You got to find it in Him. It's in Christ. It's in Christ. It's in Christ. You got to find your hiding place in Christ. Come on, with your hands lifted up. Why don't we all now come down to the front and acknowledge Him as our hiding place? Why don't we all fill the spaces? Fill the spaces and acknowledge Him as our hiding place. Come on. Come on, let's acknowledge Him. Acknowledge Him as our hiding place.